हेलो
हेलो
वेलकम यू टू सर। वेरी शॉर्टली वी विल स्टार्ट आवर सेशन।
गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू। आई हैव ऑलरेडी ज्वाइंड। यू कैन स्टार्ट द सेशन इफ द नंबर ऑफ पार्टिसिपेंट्स इज सैटिस्फैक्टरी।
ओके थैंक यू सर।
हेलो मैडम, हैज मिस्टर अंजन सेन जॉइंट? गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीबॉडी। हेलो, ओके ओके, अंजन, आई कैन सी मिस्टर अंजन सेन हैज जॉइंट एंड ऑल्सो डॉक्टर प्रवीण शर्मा हैज जॉइंट एंड आवर डायरेक्टर सर हैज जॉइंट, सो वी कैन एक्चुअली स्टार्ट द सेशन। सर, डायरेक्टर सर, तो विद योर काइंड परमिशन वी आर स्टार्टिंग द सेशन।
ओके, यू कैन स्टार्ट द सेशन, नो इश्यू।
ओके, Good morning. So we, the organizer, myself, Dr. Rajiv Banerjee and Dr. Dola Sinha, and on behalf of the R&D cell, PREC, welcome you all at the webinar on innovation and intellectual property protection. So on this occasion, we have our eminent speaker, is Dr. Praveen Sharma. He is the lead IPM in Biologics Division, Dr. Reddy Laboratory, Hyderabad. And Mr. Anjun Sen, Principal and Managing Patent Attorney and Advocate, Kolkata. We also welcome Dr. Piyush Pal Rai, Director, BCREC, Director, Dr. BCI Indian College, Durgapur. This is Ruma Mitro, Register, Dr. BCI Indian College, Durgapur. Professor Dr. Chandan Kumar Ghosh, Professor and Head, R&D, Dr. BCI Indian College, Durgapur. We also welcome eminent academicians, professors, scientists, research scholars and students to this webinar. Innovation means doing something new that improves a product, process or service. Invention is the bedrock of innovations. An invention can be protected through intellectual property, IP rights, and thus can be patented. Generally, to do this, an inventor needs to demonstrate that their technology is new, novel, useful, and not obvious to someone working in the related field. So with this short introduction, I will just call our respected director, Dr. Piyush Pal Rai, with his kind words to inaugurate this session. Sir, if you can just take the mic.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Rajiv Banerjee. I welcome you all in this very important webinar, Innovations and Intellectual Property Protection, conducted by two of our very senior faculty members, Dr. Rajiv Banerjee, who is the member of our R&D cell, and also Dr. Dola Sinha, who is the coordinator of IPR cell, which works under R&D cell. I also welcome all the senior faculty members, as well as the educationists, scientists, students in this very important webinar. My respectful invitation or the welcome, I extend my respectful welcome to our both the speakers, Mr. Anjun Sen, as Dr. Banerjee told that he's a patent attorney and advocate, principal and managing patent attorney and advocate Anjun Sen and associates from Calcutta, as well as Dr. Praveen Sharma, lead IPM in Biologics Division, Dr. Reddy's Laboratory, Hyderabad. In this respect, I could remember that Indian Institute of Management, actually Ahmedabad, they used to conduct this type of courses. I also attended nearly two decades ago. There, I am telling to everybody that there is a very famous book of Prabuddha Ganguly on IPR. So you please have this book, because you see, nowadays what is happening, everywhere the government of India, as well as the ministry, AICT, everywhere, and ACRB specifically, DST, ACRB, they're all telling that you have to do certain translational research. That is, your research must culminate with some product. And if you develop some product, then you have to know that what is the intellectual property rights, that is the IPR, you have to know the IPR. Whenever you will file some patent, so some knowledge of this kind of things is very much pertinent at this juncture. So I think that it is a very right time that to hold this type of actually webinar, Innovations and Intellectual Property Protection. We do not know. Many of the faculty members, I think that they are not knowing that once you publish your research output, you cannot actually submit a patent for that one. There are many other rules and regulations on all these things. Whenever you will develop certain products, as we are also emphasizing for the product development. So I think that this is a very pertinent steps And both the speakers are very renowned speakers, because you see, Dr. Reddy's laboratory is one of the highest patent filing agency in this country. We know that in our 20 decades ago, there was one lady also represented Dr. Reddy's laboratory. He was so fluent and he was having so much of knowledge. So these are the things, actually, it is a new area where everybody should know that what are the rules, what are the regulations, how to make the patent, then how to keep the patents also, what are the corresponding expenditure for keeping a patent, how long you will be keeping your patent, what will be your expected market expectancy. So all these things are very important. So I think that this is a very good steps, and I hope that all the participants will be benefited through the deliberations of our learned speakers. I am also requesting all the learned speakers, that is Mr. Anjan Sen and Dr. Praveen Sharma, whenever this pandemic situation, it is just going to end also within a couple of months, because vaccine has already arrived in the market. So please visit our institution. It's a very beautiful institution at the eastern part of this country. And we have nearly 3,200 engineering students in this campus, and 1,100 professional courses students are staying and residing and taking their educations here. So we'll be very happy if you can interact personally with the students after a couple of months. Please accept our invitation for that. With these few words, I welcome you all once again. And thank you very much. And also, I hope that 2021, unlike 2020, this year will be very fruitful, and you will all stay very happily, and you will enjoy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your nice speech. So I will now ask Dola Madam, Dr. Dola Sinha, to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Anjan Sen.
Good afternoon, sir. It's our great pleasure to have Mr. Anjan Sen among us, and it has been my great privilege to introduce him. Mr. Anjan Sen is a principal and managing patent attorney and advocate, Anjan Sen and Associates, Kolkata, India. He is handling IPR registration, prosecutions, contested proceedings, and enforcement in various branches of IP rights, including in various technical fields in patents, trademarks, design, and copyrights laws for more than 30 years. He is specialized in legal scope, analytics, and coverage of variety of intellectual property rights, and highly experienced in techno-legal prosecutions of variety of IPR subjects in India and abroad, and has successfully driven several thousands of grants of IPR subjects in India and abroad. Apart from extending professional services to reputed multinational and corporate entities, has been over the years impaneled and regularly handling matters as patent attorney and IPR advocate of highly respected and trusted Indian government authorities, research institutes in India, such as Department of Atomic Energy, DAE, DST, DRDO, CDOT, ICAR, NRDC, SAIL, BARC, Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, etc. Premier Technical Education Research Institute universities in India, such as the Inter-University Accelerator Center, IIT Kharagpur, IIT Bhubaneswar, IIT Guwahati, NITs including NIT Durgapur, NIT Arunachal Pradesh, University of Calcutta, Tejpur University, IIEST Sipur, etc. He is actively involved in IPR awareness programs as faculty member in workshops and seminars organized by various international and national organizations such as Government of India and Government of West Bengal initiative, including Department of Science and Technology, DST TIFAC, various IPR training programs, IPR seminars of national and international importance, including government-funded research institutes, technical academic institutes, law university, Rajiv Gandhi School of Intellectual Property Laws, specializing in IP laws, Chamber of Commerce, CII, MSMEs, and also those organized by World Intellectual Property Organization, WIPO, Indian Patent Office, and many more. He is a contributing author in IPR-related periodical books, articles, including international publications. And above all, he is an external member of IPR cell of our college. Cordial welcome to you, sir. Now the platform is yours.
Yes, thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dr. Dula Sinha, for the kind introduction. And respected director, Dr. B.C. Roy College, and the respected participants of today's workshop. I hope I am clearly audible to you all. Is it okay? Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Am I
yes,
audible?
Sir.
Okay, thank
yes,
you.
Yes, sir, you are welcome.
So it's really indeed my pleasure to have this opportunity to interact with you all today. And I think the topic for the day is IPR in engineering subjects. And I have been given the option to deliver on copyright in industrial designs. So I will be keeping my brief and keep in accordance with the topic allotted to me. Now, before I traverse into the industrial design copyright part, I think we need to know a bit of the economics behind the IPR law. As our honorable director has just now mentioned, the importance of IPR. So what happens in IPR is that it is a creation of the human intellect. So it is an intellectual goods, and it is expensive to create but cheap to reproduce. You know, in today's world, we have so many reproducible technologies in hand, or even gadgets to access various documents and information readily with these web servers, everything in place. So but the creation of the human mind, which leads to this intellectual creativity, that takes lot of capital expenditure, lot of human intellectual expenditure, and then only you can land up into an intellectual property right, capable based property right, or a service, or whatever is your creative effort. So this pathway is pretty expensive, pretty cumbersome, and it deserves a kind of protection. Now, unless you give this protection and recognition and exclusive rights to the creator or the author or his or her assignees, then what happens is that the urge for more and more creativity, and creativity is again linked to the societal development or the industrial development of a national cause. So all these are interrelated subject matters. And in today's world, I think with this pandemic situation and this COVID issue that we are all facing even today, we have seen how the race for advancement to really even safeguard the human survival on Earth has taken place. Now, this race for survival, creation of vaccines, development of masks, development of sanitizers. I remember that since this COVID thing came up, there has been flood of filing of applications for IPR, which related to this pandemic situation. So you see, the human mind is the only creative faculty which can really safeguard our survival and existence. And so it has got a societal impact. And so accordingly, it is very vital that IPR should be respected and protected and exclusively honored for the creative efforts of the individual authors. Now, these are the broad gamuts of IPR, principally one of the technical areas where creativity revolves in IPR is the patents, where functional integers or in case of chemical compounds, compositions, new and inventive product formulations, etc., you can get unpatented there. We have the trademarks for the branding of various products. We have industrial designs, which I will be elaborating a bit further today. We have plant varieties. We have copyrights. We have geographical indications. We have layout designs of integrated circuits. And finally, we also have confidential information and trade secret as another form of IPR, provided you are capable of keeping it as your exclusive right within the closed doors of your lab or yourself. So this is broadly the gamut of intellectual property right that we see all across us. And I can tell you that the world today has now, fortunately or unfortunately, either way you look at it, has headed towards a situation where I at least I foresee that the future of the market, global market, will be IP driven. See, none of us, when we go to the market to purchase any product or to avail any services, we look for an age-old product or an age-old service. So we are always looking forward to something which is new and advanced, which will serve our causes or requirements more effectively. So accordingly, what happens is that we need to ensure that we are able products, our R&D system in our country. And another very important factor, which, because you, I'm glad that you have organized this sort of a workshop today, particularly being an engineering institute, I believe India and Indian R&D should gear up to this challenge of IP-driven market race. See, that is a nationalistic requirement today. It is, I would say that long are the days, those are gone, that when we were debating whether patent, IPR and all these are required in our country or not. Incidentally, we had our IP laws in place since 1911. And post-independence, we had also geared up our laws so that the national R&D can develop new and advanced intellectual property rights all across, and we can make ourselves prominent in the global sphere as far as IP is concerned. But then, unfortunately, if you look at the statistics today, as far as our in-house, means I am talking about the national in-house capacity of generating IPR is concerned, is not that looking that bright as of now, because hardly about, say, 10% or maybe 8% to max 15% of local IP rights are getting filed in India, whereas most of the filings which are done in India are on subject matters which originated outside India. So it is only to lay hand on the Indian market that possibly these companies, multinationals, are coming and filing applications for IP rights in India. But as I said, the world is now a global village. We all call it like that. We know what is going on in every corner of the world, opening our nets or looking at our TVs, etc. So knowledge has transgress the boundaries of geographic boundaries. So what has happened is that in the process, if you are not capable intellectually, if you are not capable of developing IP rights, the future of these students, future engineering students, future technical students, or even people from the software sector, people who are writing codes, these are all original creative efforts. And we must ensure that all these intellectual property rights are well guarded so that our national IP pool can be enhanced beyond what it is today. As a comparative, we can always look at a very nearby country with whom we are having border issues, like China. But you will find very surprising that Chinese patent law and IP laws were much somewhere around the 90s, and our country had the IP laws 1911. But if you look at their statistics, it is startling. So no matter, we can always degrade by telling that the Chinese products are inferior, whether we buy it or not. But if you look at the statistics of the IP offices globally, China is doing far better in terms of the IP generation, local IP generation and protection. So without looking at China or even otherwise, even for our own survival, I believe the day has come when our national interest demands that we should develop our IP profile. So with this backdrop to the IP scenario, because I am glad that this sort of a workshop is being organized, it's a very important and opportune moment for every one of us. So now I get into the subject of industrial designs. Now you see, industrial design is nothing very big, but the issue is that, again, we come back to IP and market-driven IP and all these things. What happens is that whenever we go to buy any product in the market, now you see, while we are looking for functional advantages for a product, or the diverse functional attributes that you get out of a product in your while making your choice. At the same time, the eye appeal for the product is also one of the critical aspects that we always look for. Suppose you can take the examples of you want to purchase a mobile phone. So you see, we are always guided by the looks of the article. The functions of Apple, Samsung, and all these would vary. But even the looks gives us a bit of a inclination towards purchasing that particular product. Now, this look, which some author or a creator has provided for the article, is his or her intellectual creativity. So someone at the drawing table must have developed that particular artwork or that particular design of the product, which has been applied ultimately to the industrial product. And then that product has gone in the market, and then consumers are getting attracted by the looks, and then you are purchasing. So look at it. So IP, design, customer, commercialization. So all these are linked. So this is where the importance of IP lies. So India has got a long history of this design registration. Now, 1911, I said that we had the Designs Act. But then in 2000, there was a need for amendment of the Indian Designs Law. Because you see, India joined that trade-related aspects of intellectual property, and India became a member of the World Trade Organization and all these. So what happened, Indian IP laws, which were a little bit backdated, those had to be updated in keeping with the international commitments that India government of India had signed. So for these, in 2000, some amendments were done in the Designs Law. And some of the critical aspects of this amendment were that article, means previously what happened was that any article which was capable of being registration as far as industrial design was concerned, it should have been a finished article on its own. But then what happened is that even parts of an article, like I will give you an example, like a wristwatch, you know, the band would be a part of the wristwatch. Okay. So now you can design the band of the wristwatch and then you get it registered, even if it doesn't have its own existence. Of course, you can go and change the band per se, but as an article, it would be a band for a wristwatch. So even without the watch on top, if you design the band which the watch actually keeps on our hand, that also is a registrable subject matter. Another very pertinent point which has cropped up is the absolute worldwide novelty which has taken effect from 2000. So previous to 2000, whatever Designs Law we had, it was something like that, whether it was published anywhere in India or not. So had that thing not been published in India, you still could have got a design registration on. But after 2000, there is absolute novelty. So any design which you claim to be new and original needs to be recorded and registered, provided that you have met the condition of novel and original all across the globe. So there is absolute novelty conditions for your registration. Finally, we also started classifying the articles for the purposes of registration in keeping with the international system of classification of goods under the Designs Law. So Locarno classification, India became a member of this signatory to the Locarno classification. And this is the Locarno classification. Now what happens, it's not a very big issue. It's only that various goods are classified into respective classes. Let us take an example. Travel goods will fall under class 3. Within travel goods, there will be subclass 3.1, that is trunk, suitcases, briefcases. Subclass 3x3 would be sunshades, walking sticks, etc. 3x4 would be fans, etc. Household goods, china, glassware would be class 7, subclass 0.1. Table knives would be subclass 7, subclass 3, 7x03. Fireplace implements 7x08. So this is how you get the classification of the goods that you want to register, and you have to mention the class or the subclass under which you want to register your design, and then you can effectively get that registration done. Now, what does this Designs Law actually talk about? It actually talks about, as I said, it is the eye appeal of a particular product. Now, you see, we all know that eye appeals can be imported or implied or applied to a product either on two dimension or even on three dimension. So the Designs Law keeps it open
that even two-dimensional designs, like for example the middle one over here, it is a that ceramic tiles, you know, we are using ceramic tiles also on the walls today in kitchens, etc., or maybe in some even on your in front of your workstation. So here, if the tile shape and configuration is rectangular is known, but then on the surface of that, there is an artwork attached to that, and that artwork is applied to an industrial product, that is a tiles, then that particular two-dimensional design is also registrable. Now, this one is a thing on a garment. Even garment, fashion designing is now a very, very vital, attraction in to the young generation. So even on fashion designing, even on your dress material, suppose I have no hesitation in saying that when we talk about industrial product, we always think about some machinery going around or something. But look at it, even your garment designs can come under the aspect of industrial design. So three-dimensional designs, you cut a cloth in a particular manner. Now mind it, people actually overlook all these things. Even I say that even when you are doing a fashion designing, or you are cutting your cloth, or by virtue of that you are able to give more comfort, you know, while wearable comfort, there may be avenues not only of industrial design, there may be also avenues of patenting that also. I'm not going much into details because some other speaker would be there who will be covering in detail patent, but what I'm just giving an insight that there can be patentable subject matter even on design subject matters of a garment design. It can be done. So this is just to open up your minds. Nothing, because we our mind must first be cleared up that what all is the scope and ambit of IP. We cannot be just focused on your academics and just very focused on your studies, getting numbers and all this, because those I believe those days will slowly change. You need to translate your academics into the marketplace product, socio-economic development of the nation. So you need to think in a different perspective. You need to apply your academics in a different mindset. You have to open up. If you are not opening up your mind, you are only on the academics and scoring numbers. I think the world today is changing. The one who solves problems will get the accolades, will get the rights, get the privileges. And more our country learns in solving problems, not only national problems, but global problems. You would find that our country will more and more be in the prominence. So this is the vital part, I would say, that which is very, very important, and you must carry in your mind. It's not that just a one-hour deliberation that the purpose should be that get yourself ingrained into all these IP, right? Because I would say that the future is like this. Carrying on academic studies without IPR is like wasting your time on academics. It may translate into that. So please, because world is very competitive, products and services have become competitive. So unless you can contribute to that competitive world, I think our academic efforts may not bear the right fruits. So this is the situation as far as now we can have two dimensions, three dimensions. Now, what are registrable designs? As I said, new and original means absolute novelty should be there globally. Has not been disclosed to the public anywhere in any tangible form or use or any other way prior to the date of filing or priority date. Now, patents and designs. Please mind it, I was discussing in the first slide that what are the various forms of IP. Patents and designs are very, very critical in terms of keeping those confidential, because your own publication, if you do a publication, if your own publications, in case your own publications are lost and given away in the public domain, what happens is that your own publication will be cited in a subsequent date filing of your patent or design application. So please ensure that you are not providing or losing upon your IP rights, because IP rights is something why a lawyer like me should come for a deliberation in, or be at all invited for a deliberation before a group of engineering students or faculty, is because this is an area where you are translating your technological efforts, creativity, into a legal exclusivity. See, it is not just a scientific literature, mind it. IP rights, statutory rights, which you obtain by patent design and all these are legal rights. Like when you purchase a car, you go to the motor vehicles and get it recorded. You purchase a real estate property, you go to the municipalities and get it registered. So technological advancement that you do, you need to register it to retain your exclusive ownership rights. So this is where this aspect of IP and everything is crossing up, and that is where the legal translation comes up. Because you people are experts in your technical domain, there's no point of this sort of a deliberation today, because you have your academics with you. It is already there. But the point is that you are trying to get into the subject of IP rights, and which are legal rights. And if you are not doing your homework effectively for translating the technical right into a legal right, then mind it that there is no purpose to recording an IP right. If you are still hoping for an academic right, then possibly the legal issues or intricacies of IPR, intellectual property right, gets diluted. But no one in the actual world would like to utilize the IP system or the IP laws just for the academic purposes. So there is an attachment of commercialization, and there is an attachment of exclusivity based on that. Now look at it. I was talking to you about the eye appeal in designs. Now all multinationals, everyone, they would utilize these IP rights to really put across their products in the market, and they ensure that they do not publish it before they file their applications for the respective IP rights. Now look at the design of iMac, how over the years it has changed. Now there are designs of iPhones, iPads. These are also designed the way it looks. The technology inside is something different. You can cover by patents, functional attributes. But the look and feel, what you go to the shop to purchase, how it looks like, that also is important. That also creates an identity for a source of a product. So this is where, you know, the distinction also lies. This is where, you know, the IPR also plays a critical role. We tend to overlook it. We tend to overlook it. We believe that, no, that is something, okay, that's trivial, obvious. No. But if someone has taken a right and there is a copyright on that outlook, and tomorrow you try to go get into the market without permission of that owner, then you can land yourself in a infringement action. So there are definite issues or purposes attached to IP rights, including design rights. And we must ensure that we are really respecting our requirements of coming to this law, taking recourse to these legal rights, and respecting our creative efforts. So that is very important. Another very, regular day by day in, day out example whereby we can really spot what we mean by visual to the eye. Now you see, we have those sugar particles. Every day we are taking in a teaspoonful of sugar in our tea, coffee, etc. Now these sugar particles, even if you give a, you know, diamond shape, suppose you give a very, very unique diamond shape to sugar particles. Now, unless you use a microscope before using in a cup of tea, you won't get the benefit or feel of that change in shape and configuration of the sugar particle. But the design's law says that anything that is qualifiable for a registrable design should be visible by the naked eye. So you cannot use a microscope to, or the controller will not use a microscope to see that, yes, you have developed a new design of sugar particles and then give you a registration. So it is whether whatever design you have applied to any article, whether it is visible to your normal eyesight, and whether it can be decipherable that, yes, something new has happened. That is the crux of this design's law and the eyesight IAP. So particles of sugar being very minute, our eye will not distinguish even if we try to incorporate a new shape and color. So this sort of not noticeable by our eyesight, this sort of designs are not actually qualifiable designs. But then if you assemble the particles of sugar and then turn into some shape and configuration which is different from the normal sugar cubes, like heart-shaped, you know, these sugar blocks, this is visible to the eye. So there is a guest in your house and you then open up this sugar pot and they find, oh, this is something different. So the same particles of sugar has been agglomerated, given a shape, and now it translates into a valuable design or product. And you can get it registered. Exclusive right. No one can reproduce without your consent. So this is just an example that how eye appeal does matter in terms of qualifying your registrable subject matters. Now, as far as industrial products are concerned, there are a wide variety. You see, this is an example of a washing machine. Now it is all utility equipments. Everything. Any dishwashers, washing machines, etc. Anything you have in your kitchen where you can make it attractive, you can make it something unique. So in this case also, you would find that, you see, the design of the washing machine is something different. I show other. So you see, just visualize that without looking at anything else, how the design is making a change in our perception. So you go to the purchase a washing machine, you would be left with so many options. And mind it that ultimately, okay, the functions, the price ranges are definite considerations for a customer. But that apart, you know, this shape applied to an article would definitely play a role. So that is another very, 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 very critical factor. So look at the designs. I'm just showing it. See, these are different eye appealing shapes and configurations which are going on. Look at another one. This is a from the games and toys, toy building elements. You know, these children, they can build anything out of, you know, combination of modules, modular structures. So even if you have created, now there can be functions attached. Mind it, I am repeating again that IP right is a very, very strategic mind game. And to a technocrat, whenever he or she believes that something out of his or her hard efforts have cropped up, or even if it is hard effort in some way that you are regularly working on your research and developmental activities and trying to solve some problem, but then when you are not in the lab but maybe relaxing on a Sunday, something catches up in your mind looking at some other gadget that, okay, this implement can provide for the solution that I'm looking for in my lab. So that can also be your, that may be the starting point of your IP. So right from that starting point of conceptualizing the IP, to taking it forward in your lab and then crystallizing your thoughts in the form of an article or a device. This entire pathway is your IP right building pathway. And never, never ever undermine any of the stages of this development. See, I am repeating, it's a very, very complex and highly competitive world, technological world that we are getting into, where you not only have to be aware about what is going on all across the globe, but you also have to develop your skill levels to be competitive against the global world. You cannot just be competitive within your lab. You cannot be just be competitive within your nation, state, or maybe within your nation. Because as I said, that the IP laws, fortunately or unfortunately, we have signed agreements whereby we say that, no, our country will also recognize only global technological advancements. So if we have committed to that, we have no chance of relaxation today. We cannot relax. If we are trying to relax today, then that commitment which has been done, it will pull you down, 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 day by day. So there's no option. What I mean is that it is essential to imbibe within your system the creative efforts towards IPR. It is very vital. Otherwise, you would be missing the bus. Look at another example, engineering thing, glass holding bracket. Simple things. But mind it that all these gadgets or implements which I am trying to show under the industrial design, this can have an equivalent, right, or a more functionally more, you know, versatile or flexible right under the patent law. But ultimately, when you sell the product in the market, it assumes a particular shape and configuration, isn't it? So this particular shape and configuration, apart from its functional attributes, may be obtained by some other variants of that shape, which can be covered by a patent. This particular shape and configuration deserves a protection under the industrial designs copyright. Because otherwise, you would be leaving your actual embodiment, which you might have spent another additional time to reach to that particular form, which you are readily providing to your customers. And another very important factor, what goes on into this is that, see, there under a patent, you might cover functional elements and cover, you know, if you people are exposed to the patent, or you might have Dr. Sharma would be taking up that patent issue. So in a claim, what happens, patent claim, it's not readily readable into the one specific embodiment. It can cover multiple embodiments of a particular technical advancement. Whereas in a design, we are trying to block the embodiment that we are putting across in the market. So this is where the difference between patent and the design comes. So design is an immediate thing, which the customers get readily in a tangible form, and you need to cover that also. So this is how you cover your thing. This is a fender for motorcycles. Any article, as I said, that even because of this 2000 amendment, even parts of an article, fender guards for motorcycles, a part of an article. Even part of an article which is capable of being manufactured and sold separately can also be protected by virtue of an industrial design. So you can do that. This is another one, waste bin. Our regular utility item, waste bins. You develop a new, you know, design of a waste bin. You want exclusive rights on that. Go to the designs office before publishing and get yourself recorded for that. That's practicable. People can do it. So this is how we can build on. This is another one is seatbelt. Seatbelts we all wear while driving, or if you are sitting on the front of your car. So the design of the seatbelt, it is a part of an article, part of the car industry. So that also comes under this. So everything which are tangible things which we handle in our daily lives. In the morning you get up, you use a brush, toothbrush. If you develop a novel, you know, designer toothbrush. Forget about the material. Material may be the same age-old plastic material or polymeric material with nylon fibers. But then if you design it in a different manner, it gives a different outlook. Then that can be a subject matter of a design. So anything, any article that you think of, this is a door handle. So I'm just giving you certain examples which actually would enlighten that the broad and wide spectrum under which this design's law gives us the coverage. This is one case law I just want to briefly traverse, because this has got an implication on, this is nothing big. What this case law says is that it was held that label put on a carton to be used on a container for goods can never amount to design within the meaning of Section 2(3) of the Designs Act. Now, it is nothing big. It is like you take a plain piece of paper, and if you simply draw a scenery on that. So this judgment has mentioned that because the plain paper had no function on its own except for carrying the, you know, inking or pencil sketches on it. So paper and anything, so this sketch applied on the paper is not an article per se. So here you are not applying the design on an article, because the article has no function on its own. So this sort of sketches or artworks which you create, these can go and covered by another form of intellectual property, that is as an artistic creation under the copyrights law. So paper sketches, you are drawing the Taj Mahal in your own way. That is also an intellectual skill. But that will come under the artistic copyright. Because the law says that doing sketches on a paper is not a qualifiable article, because it doesn't have its own function. But with the paper, you create a function of the paper, like a wallpaper. Now a wallpaper becomes a functional part. You see, it's an article. You go to the shop and purchase wallpapers. It is not an ordinary paper on which you write and scribble. Okay? So if a paper has some other function, and on that, top of that, you do certain two-dimensional, three-dimensional designer works, then those become qualifiable subject matter under the Designs Law. So this is the difference. Now, similar this is, you know, this Handloom Cooperative Society, Sambalpuri, they have done this designer things on wall hangings, the textile wall hangings. These are articles per se. Whether you apply this design on it or not, it will be sold as an article. Okay. So this article, if you put any designer patterns, two-dimensional, three-dimensional, whatever you feel like, and you believe that this is your own creation, then you can go and take design registration of this, subject to your not putting it in open public domain. So this is how you can really extend your creativity into actual hard articles, and then lay your exclusive rights on the creativity also. So this is just a registration of that same thing. Now here goes another example where you see there is a typical Section 4 of the Designs Act, which says that if you are just combining features available to be applied to a particular article without significant difference in eye appeal, In that case, those sort of designs cannot be said to be new designs. Like this is an example, we are all in the market, it is quite flooded, this Crocs footwears. Now you see, they always have that some holes provided on the top for air circulation and all these things. So they had filed certain applications for design registration, and then they found that some company by the name Liberty Shoes, they were manufacturing same type variety of shoes. So they took them to the court. Now, Liberty Shoes, they in the court, they showed that, as I said, that in designs, you cannot publish your designs before you file an application for design registration. But Liberty Shoes, they could lay hand on certain prior publication before the date on which these Crocs people applied for their designer shoes in India under the designs law, that the same, you know, hole-based footwear, etc., was in public domain. And they relied on that and then said that it is prior published. So even if it comes from their sources, or they might have sold it to some party and they might have put it across on the net or whatever, the way in which this this document has been laid open before the date of actual filing of the application, that is clearly indicative of the fact that it was prior published before the date of filing. And then the courts also, honorable courts also deciding this matter, also held that now if a footwear with which has been published, it has got four holes, and now the one that you have filed for a subsequent design registration, it has got seven holes. Now this number of holes and this and that, it would not be perceptible as an innovation as far as the new design is concerned. So the courts held that even if you are playing with the holes and the designs of it vis-a-vis the earlier published one, you have to have some bit of ingenuity in giving it some different eye appealing shape and configuration. If that is not adequately provided, then what happens is that then you are not well covered, or you have not well exemplified the novelty and originality in your creativity. So that cannot be held to be novel. So some of the critical guidelines which we can always keep in mind is that the guidance from precedence as to a certain novelty distinction has to be drawn between usual trade variants on one hand and novelty and originality on the other. For drawing such distinction, reliance has to be placed on popular impression, for which the eye has to be the ultimate arbiter. However, the eye should be an instructed eye, capable of seeing through to discern whether it is common trade knowledge or a novelty so striking and substantial as to merit registration. A balance has to be struck so that novelty and originality may receive the statutory recognition and interest of trade, and right of those engaged therein to share common knowledge be also protected. So a balance needs to be created. See, all these forms of IPR, they are in place not to recognize random XYZ things as IPR. So all these statutory provisions of IP rights have always placed on record or prescribed for certain qualifying requirements for the purposes of registration. So if those requirements are legal obligations are not met, then even those filing of applications for registration can be nullified, can be rejected by the controller, or even in a contested proceedings, it can be invalidated. Mind it that grant of a registration is not a proof of the validity. The law clearly recites that. So it is subject to challenge. So when you create any IP right and you think of taking coverage of that IP under the legal sphere of intellectual property registrations, it is extremely important, particularly for patents and designs, where novelty on the date of your filing is prerequisite, that you do a very, very honest background research. See, if you are not doing a proper background research and coming for patent and design registration, it is like wasting your time on reinventing the wheel. Don't do that. Because I again say that if you are interested in IPR, please ensure that you are respecting the legal provisions and then trying to obtain IPR. Because there are a lot of hurdles. It is not like your scientific paper that you write it down as per your findings and everything. And if those findings are okay, then it qualifies. What happens in IP rights is that you have to respect or direct your findings in a particular well-tuned, legally tuned document. And lodge your claims in that particular tune, which is legally acceptable. No matter what you write down or what you try to say, maybe something fantastic. But if the nature of the claims that you have drawn, the legal claims, legal exclusive rights, are not well codified, well defined, I'm sorry that either it can face rejection or it can lead to certain things where you may not be adequately protected. Again, I'm repeating, IPR is a serious factor to retain exclusive rights, to benefit the society, to benefit the nation in industrial development, in reaching more user-friendly products to the ultimate customers. So application of your academic knowledge in the industrial sphere, and while doing that, you have to gauge the scope of your coverage. It's a very vital thing. IP rights are basically intangible rights. So you can take a right and then you may not be regularly manufacturing in the industry, but then your rights should be such that anyone who is interested in obtaining that right from you would feel safe that yes, your claims on IP are genuine claims, are self-defining claims, multi-embodiment coverage claims, legally enforceable claims. If it is not, then it may be your academic satisfaction still going that a patent has been published in your name. But the very purpose of IP to bring your knowledge domain in the industry, retain exclusivity, get commercial output out of it, plow back that money again for future R&D, that is how human or the society or the nation survives or advances. So if we are not inculcating, if we are not really focusing ourselves into that domain of development of IP, then again, possibly we are missing the bus. Look at this. This religious insignias are all well known. Just to give an example. But if you apply that for the first time in an article, like these are LED lamps. So this creator, he used this religious insignia in LED lamps for the first time. He got design validly subsisting. So these insignias are known, but your application is original. So look at the scope of coverage that you can have. Any substance, capsules and tablets, fertilizer tablets, C-shaped, or you want to make a D-shaped tablet. No one has done it before. Why not? Go and register and you put it in the market. Let the customers also know that it is your tablet, looking at the shape of the tablet, apart from consuming or using that tablet for the particular functions that it does. So these are avenues in which you can enrich yourself, you can enrich your product lines, you can make your product lines visible to the market. IP is a long drawn stage-wise application and utility. So you need to advance that in a manner which will really, really open up your mind and make you something different looking in the marketplace. And at the same time, utilization of your academic faculties, like cricket bat and a ball, these are known things. We know these shapes. But then if you create a eraser out of it by combining the two, no one has done it. So your application of this cricket ball and is original. No matter its shape was known for ages since our childhood. So you can apply it. So designs law recognizes these new original applications as well. So look at the scope. And this is another, these electronic calculators. Those were very famous at one point of time. So someone came up with a Cadbury design, the children's Cadburys, in the shape and configuration of a electronic calculator. Now the electronic calculator fellows took them to the court. They said that it was my design. Now the court held that, you see, this designs law is a totally different perspective. It gives coverages based on the articles to which you apply for a design. So if you have applied a design for a calculator, it doesn't mean that design, when applied to a Cadbury, how it looks like it would be, and it is a totally different trade zone for children. So based on the article, there can be originality in application, and you can still get a valid design registration out of it. So these are the aspects. Now, another very, apart from individual design, the law also says that you can apply designs to a set of articles. Now, what does that set mean? Set means a number of articles of this or the same general character, ordinarily sold together or intended to be used together, all bearing the same design without modification, not sufficiently to alter the character or substantially to affect the identity thereof. So a set of articles can also go under one application, provided the condition that the articles are of same general character, ordinarily sold together or intended to be used together, all bearing the same design, with or without modification, not sufficient to alter the character or substantiality to affect the identity thereof. So if you maintain all these conditions, and then you are able to develop a set of articles which does provide for this scope of coverage as per the legal provisions, then you are entitled. Let us take an example. A set of cufflinks and a tie clip, a set of smoking accessories, a tea set, a coffee set, a set of table knives, a set of furnitures, a set of air conditioners, a set of golf clubs, seat covers for automobiles, set of audio equipments, list goes on. So you can register and block these as a set also, because all these components define a common, designer aspect. Like in the patents we have, when you have multiple claims under one application, the controller will say that, oh, these are all different inventions, file, give different application fees for each of these claims. And the attorneys will go on arguing, no, this is a common inventive. All the claims involve a common inventive aspect. So these are all originating from the common invention, and so it should come under one application, one fee. So that is for patents. But for designs, if the designs are applied uniformly to the different articles, then you can also bring all these articles, instead of registering it those separately, one against the other. You can bring everything under one basket and file a single application for design registration. This is an example, 6-piece coaster set. Look at it. The pineapple, shape of the pineapple is known, but then you apply that in a coaster for the first time. Unpublished, unknown, original application. You can get a design registration for this. This is how the coaster, when you open up, it looks like. So you can get a registration like this, you see. So I told you about the cup and saucer thing. So these usually come in sets. So if you are building, there should be a matching designer part, you know. And you want to sell them also together. So that was the definition also I read out. So if you are getting into that same compliance of the legal requirements, you are actually honoring the law. And then instead of filing separate applications for the saucer, separate application, cup, etc., file it all under one application. You can do that. Perfume bottles. Look at it. You can present someone, or it can be in a package. Same bearing some identity of design. So we say to the controller that these are set of perfume bottles of a very unique shape, and the shape carries unity in the various embodiments. So all can come under one application. So you can do that. So this is how it goes on. Now this is a sample of an application. This is a control unit again for even high-end drug delivery system. See, control unit in drug delivery system. There can be design applications for the gadgets used for drug delivery. Look at it. So you can file. So you can design it. Now there can be functional attributes. There can be patentable subject matter into the drug delivery aspect. That's a different story. But then how your drug delivery system ultimately looks vis-a-vis the other drug delivery systems which are available in the market. Go and protect it by way of a design. At least your priority of launching with a particular shape and configuration gets respected under the law. And you can carry forward that thing. You can get it registered. Same here. This is the injection window in a drug delivery system. Even part of an article, I said that the drug delivery system is maybe the composite article. The injection window in the drug delivery system, that also has been blocked separately. So you can do this. So there are so many avenues, you see, to protect. We have to just be very, you have to be always thinking, your mind should go on thinking how best to protect. Because you might have developed something, because very often I'm sure you people, while working on your R&D efforts, etc., you people must be definitely coming across some advancement which you regularly think of or do, but then you have to think of translating that into the actual applicable product domain and then get it copyrighted or patented. Look at this example, just to give an idea. This is, you see, this is Apple's design when this is that Apple's iPhone design. Now look at it. This was Steve Jobs when he was there. Before introducing their iPhones, now see they had taken design registrations. Now look at all the shapes and configurations have been covered. Now there are avenues. You see, you would find certain dotted lines and solid lines. Now this also plays a role, as I said, that you have to be very careful in what you are applying. So even when you are trying to apply for a design of a product, it is always desired that you should decipher the design into the most prominent, most important regions of your design and the optional or maybe not that required subjects of the product design, so that you can block the competitors from lifting essentially the essential part of your design. So this dotted line and these solid lines in the design actually provide you the option of, while filing your application for design, to claim effectively what is the most essential part on which you are wanting the exclusive copyright, and what is excluded from your required or disclaimed by you, although it is visible. In fact, it is visible because you want the article to look at in its finished form. But then within that, you, by dotted lines, you can make something invisible for the legal scope and yet retain exclusive rights for the essential part. So this is how you would find that this iPhone, when it was launched, so many variants of it were actually covered. And finally, the one that came up, a separate design for that was also. So initially you think of, you know, covering a wide spectrum of your designs. And then finally the one that you, which you land, and now those wide spectrum actually creates a boundary around your actual embodiment. And then the one that you actually try to launch, do a separate one for that, because that is the defined one which you are trying to attach to your company sources. So this is how you can actually frame out or fan out your design claims strategically. Like the iPad also, they took a design for this iPad, and later on we all know that there was a lot of, you know, hue and cry between Apple and Samsung as far as the iPad and tabs of Samsung were concerned. And Apple had taken the Samsung's change of design, and they related that to their iPad design, which got registered before Samsung came up with a closed design like the Apple's registered one. So this is how you see, because in the marketplace, apart from the technology underneath this Apple and Samsung thing, there's different technologies, different operating systems. But then the outlook can come very close. And if the outlook is very, very determining, very, very, you know, important, then it may that some other manufacturer might try to copy your outlook of the product, apart from being a different grade of functional grade of the product altogether. So that's always there. But this is how you see you can really modulate the shape and configuration, etc. Now, spectacle, this is another, just an example, frames for spectacles. You can register this. I'm just giving an idea that what all we regularly utilize, we regularly see around us, it is not that we are thinking of IP as something distant from our day in, day out lifestyle. These are all subject matters which are pure subjects of regular utilities. This is another jute cedar. It's a pure, see jute cedar. It's looking different. Cedars are known, but the particular outlook that you provide, that also carries a meaning. Look at the distinctness of the IAP. So people are thinking about it, because world over, everyone is pretty conscious today as to the outlook of a product, apart from the function, because we are all concerned. You go to purchase any household item or any, you know, official decor item or anything. I think our eyesights are pretty well tuned into getting the best designer product with us. So designs can be hugely beneficial. And copyright in designs is very, very vital. And I give you another example, very small example. Look at the shape and configuration of a mobile phone battery. Now, you see, even mobile phone batteries, they're made, might be spurious, duplicates which might float in the market. To stop against such duplicates, if you are a mobile phone manufacturer, you can use the same technology for the battery which people are using. It's subject to not violating anyone's proprietary right on patents or something like that. But you can create a particular, in your mobile phone, you can generate a design of the battery. in a very peculiar, in a very special way, which would ensure that even if others are trying to replicate that, since they would be violating your design, you can keep the competitors away. So this is a way of thinking ahead on in terms of how common things can be brought into the exclusive domain. So you can also think of these ways of coverage. I think I have overshot my time. Should I wind up or what's the? Hello.
It's very nice.
Nice talk, sir. Yeah. So I will just stop here then. My humble request is that I have just tried to illustrate one of the avenues of intellectual property right, that is industrial design. But you people from the engineering background, I would believe that you would have a vast, ocean of creativity in front of you. So definitely, please try to open up your mind and don't be very much focused on. You see, academics is always there. I'm repeating because unless you are not changing your stereotype to academics, IP may not be your cup of tea. So please, it's very important because I think our country has got a huge resource of technical capacity to beat anyone in the global domain. Because we all know, engineers from our academic institutions are now running so many multinational organizations. So we know the capabilities of our academic institutes for sure. Only thing is that we have not utilized ourselves into building our own IP assets. And that was because we have not focused our dreams or aspirations in a different manner, which is required in today's world. So that is very important. And I hope that this small talk of today would at least I've been able to translate the needs for IP and modulate your minds and activities on your day-to-day lifestyle and your day-to-day R&D research profiles, and try to make whatever little every day, please try to nurture your IP capabilities. Please do that. Please make it a habit, like you must be having some habits to qualify in your academic or to excel in your respective domains. Just make a habit also to bring the IP also side by side within your, then you would be the master and you can govern the world. Thank you so much for your time. Thanks a lot.
Sir, there is a question from Mr. Mahadevan.
Yes.
So can you, please, Mr. Mahadevan, can you introduce yourself and ask the question?
Yes.
So good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
This is Professor Mahadevan from Bangalore. Yeah. I was an ex scientist from ISRO. So we found that in certain cases, when you do products for some frequency bands, they can easily be scaled up or down and they can get new products. But generally, when it is patented, is the scalability also taken into account?
Yeah, that's a very good question and a very, very pertinent question. Yes, that's what I was trying to see, because my topic of the day was industrial designs. I kept myself into the realm of the actual finished designer aspects of every product, which is the aspect of IP of designs. But parallelly, I was time and again trying to bring in the patent perspective into that. So what does this patent as an IP do? It actually covers the functional technological advancement that you do. It actually blocks that by way of a very, very well-framed legal claims to your technological functional attributes attached to any product. So when you block a functional advancement in a patent claim, the scalability, whether it is a small scale utilization or a large scale utilization or the dynamics changes, so long as someone uses the principle of operation, which you have blocked by your patent claim, that gets automatically covered and anyone can fall trap to that infringement. But that is where the writing of the patent claim is very crucial. That's what I was telling, that It is not an ordinary paper publication sort of writing in a patent document because it's a legal document. So you, when you are translating the technology into a legal document, you are trying to tie up the, you know, loose ends, and you are trying to build a good block on the principle of your creativity. And once you block that principle of creativity by a patent, even if your design can be bypassed by someone by making it look differently, but the principle of operation of your subject of advancement can be effectively blocked under the patent, and you can, the matter of scalability will be no issues for you. You can still drag that fellow into the infringement of your intellectual creation.
Thank you so much for a very elaborate answer.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Any other questions from sir? Yes, sir.
Then, can I supplement a few comments?
Hello?
Dr. Sen, can I just supplement with a few comments?
Yes, please.
Actually, I was all along in your deliberation. It has been a very pertinent and very useful deliberation, I should say. I would just like to know, suppose any of the authors or any of the patentee actually by mistake, actually, if it does something, by mistake, I am telling specifically, because you see that sometimes you may not know also that who has developed which kind of things. And there are a lot of actually subdivisions of these products by mistake. Then what are the steps he has to follow to redo the matter?
If point is that at what level that mistake has come to surface, that is very important. Now you see, while you are working on your product development or something, and then you were not aware about it and you have developed it, and then you might have even lodged an application for patent or an IP right on that, and later on you come to know that someone else has done it and your one is not the claimable subject. In that case, what happens is that the patent office will also come to know, ideally, that your claims were not novel on the date of your filing. Someone else was already had published that thing. So as far as your patent claim is concerned, the patent controller or the competitor who comes to know about the prior publication, he can come and block it and your patent claim will go invalidate. So this is not a very big issue. You had lodged a claim. See, globally, everywhere, if you are lodging a claim on IPR, whether it is patent, design or whatever, it is to the best of your knowledge you are claiming that it is new and inventive.
To the best,
but if best of your knowledge, you are giving a declaration like that. So if someone comes up and finds that no, that your knowledge, you are not aware of it, and so you have to give it up, you can give it up legally, no issues. But mind it that when you are a co-author, very often we find certain inventors, they come to us and they say that I want a patent on this. And then later on, we find that that gentleman had suppressed something on which he was a co-author with someone else, and that actually creates a lot of lack of invalidity in his subsequent claim. So in those situations, you have not done to the best of your knowledge. So you have been a victim to suppression of material facts from the controller. So okay, those are not looked effectively by the legal judicial system. But if it is to the best of your knowledge, you missed it, it will only go invalid against your claims and nothing bad, nothing serious will come up.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Mrs. Manisha Pal, I think, has some question.
I have a question, okay, sir. So I'm Manish Pal from UCLA. And my question is, can we combine the design aspect of a machine along with the principle of operation together, or we should separate it out as separate patents?
Yes. So the question is again very basic in terms of the branches of IP. As I said that, see, in any product, if there is a principle of operation or technological advancement, that is not covered by the industrial design's copyright law. So in that case, you have to cover that by writing good patent claims, that the functional attributes on which you claim you have developed for the first time. So that comes under patent, but utilizing that function, the ultimate product form that you have developed and you want to introduce in the market, that eye appealing external shape and configuration of the product, that particular shape and configuration can be covered under the design. So to answer to your question, if you want to protect the principle of operation, which is new and inventive, you have to file a patent application. If you want to cover the shape and configuration of the product and its novelty and originality, you have to come under the industrial design.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, Dula madam, just see whether there are other questions or not.
Any other questions from the audience? Okay, sir, I have a small request. If you share the costing of filing a patent, so maximum of the aspirant researcher are willing to file the patent. So can you please tell us something?
On the cost?
Yes.
No, see, cost would vary depending upon whether it is an individual filing or an institute filing. Or a startup is filing, because startups have been given certain special privileges by the government. So there is a lot of difference in the official fees part. And professional fees are mostly, again, for a startup and an individual, it is in the lower range vis-a-vis an institute or a multinational or a corporate who is already into the business of IP and everything. So my suggestion would be not to make, and if you want to know about this official fees, you can just log into the Indian Patent Office site and you will find that what I just now mentioned, individual, startups and legal entities, the official fees are categorized in separate blocks, separate columns. So you can just log in there and put in the charges for filing patent applications or design applications. And there will be a schedule, it will pop up and you can just have a look at it. So this is where the thing, and as far as the professional charges, we usually do not prefer to put any ballpark thing, because it varies depending upon the subject matter, the number of iterations that we have to carry forward with the inventor, etc. So although we always try to make it cost effective, but there's no point putting any boundaries to that straight away without knowing the subject matter. So I would refrain from that part, but the official fees, please, if you visit the official site, you can get it. Or if someone is having problem, you can just send me across an email. I will just guide you further on that. No issues.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for your valuable speech. And we know lots of small things like brass, shoes, spectacles, etc., that can be patentable for its design. I think our students and the aspirant researchers are influenced by your informative speech, and seriously, they will transform their idea to the prototype and register for the patent. And so thank you very much, sir. Once again, we will look for your next lecture. And till now, we will move for a lunch break, and next we will join sharp 2 p.m. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you
so
thank
much.
Thank
you, sir.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you, Mr. Sen.
Thank you.
I just one announcement that next session will start from 2 p.m. So we'll have a short break of half an hour. Our next speaker will be Dr. Praveen Sharma. And I also invite Mr. Sen in that session also. If you have if you can come and see the lecture.
I am sorry, I have some hearings to be attended, so I beg to be excused for that. Thank you so much.
And I think audience are invited with your valuable speech. And another thing, some of the means participants I am seeing, they have also earlier came to our webinar, just Professor Madhavan. He is from ISRO, so he has attended many webinars on our side. Then Shoman Chakravarti also. There will be, after that session, second session, there will be a feedback, and then for the certificates also. So we'll wind up this session and we'll see in 2 p.m.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.